All right, good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending on where you are in the world. On behalf of USAID, Feed the Future, and AgriLinks, I want to welcome you to our webinar, Increasing Food Security Through Safe, Nutritious Diets. I am Michael Saltz with AgriLinks, and before we begin, I want to orient you to our BlueJeans platform. On the right side of your screen, you'll see most of your controls. Please use the chat to introduce yourself and network with colleagues from around the world. To ask questions, please feel free to use the Q&A button on the bottom right and indicate who your question is for. You can ask questions throughout the webinar and upvote questions that you most want answered. Our Q&A session will be at the end of the event. If the presentation is too small on your screen, you can use the slide bar at the bottom of the window to adjust the view. Lastly, we are recording this webinar and will email you the post-event resources as soon as they are available. You can also find the resources at agrilinks.org when they are available. I will now pass it to USAID's Nika Larian. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Michael, and thank you to all of you for joining us. And welcome to the Food Safety Theme Month webinar, exploring how we can increase food security through safe, nutritious diets in honor of World Food Safety Day on June 7th. Today, we are joined by an excellent panel of experts. We will begin with opening remarks from Kelly Cormier, Food Safety Division Chief in the Center for Nutrition within the U.S. Agency for International Development's Bureau for Resilience and Food Security. She oversees a portfolio that supports the U.S. government's global food security strategy and USAID's multi-sectoral nutrition strategy. Next, we will hear three presentations from our panelists. First, Anne Girardi is the Senior Manager in charge of Regulatory Affairs, Public-Private Partnerships, and global capacity building programs for GFSI, the Global Food Safety Initiative. For 7 years, she has overseen public-private partnerships, capacity building, and regulatory affairs on food safety and sustainable development goals activities for GFSI Global at the Consumer Goods Forum. Next, we have Alimatu Zheng, owner of Carvi Food, the first Senegalese dried meat production company. Carvi Food has been supported by USAID's Feed the Future Business Drivers for Food Safety Project, BD4FS, to promote the adoption of food safety practices, which helped Alimatu secure a lucrative supply contract with a major food retailer in Senegal. And third, we have two panelists from the Food Safety Innovation Lab. Andrea Berseman is an associate professor at the University of Alaska Fairbanks. Berseman's research focuses broadly on preventing nutrition-related health disparities among underserved minority youth and their families. Also, we have Abiodun Atole, an incoming assistant professor at Utah State University, who holds a PhD in nutrition science. She seeks to understand ways to close the nutrition and health gaps experienced by low-resource families, refugees, and immigrant communities. As Michael said, we will wrap up today's presentations with a question and answer period. So please utilize the Q&A function during the presentations. And with that, I will hand things over to Kelly Cormier.
Thank you, Nika. I'm excited to open this webinar that will focus on how critical food safety is to food security. We've assembled an exceptional panel who will provide diverse perspectives on the links between food safety interventions and impacts on availability, access, and affordability of safe and nutritious food. It's really quite simple. If food is not safe, it's not food, and it certainly isn't nutritious. Fundamentally, we know that food security exists when all people at all times have the physical, social, and economic access to sufficient, safe, and nutritious food that meets their dietary needs and food preferences. And before we hear from the panelists, I just want to leave you with three things to consider as you listen. First, we have a new U.S. government global food security strategy, the GFSS, and this reinforces the importance of food safety in reducing the high level goals of poverty, hunger, and malnutrition. The GFSS is a whole of government approach that aims to end global hunger, poverty, and malnutrition, and it guides the Feed the Future initiative. So guided by this new strategy, now really is the time to find new ways to integrate food safety, address food safety risks within Feed the Future activity designs. Reducing food safety risks increases and sustains Feed the Future impact related to hunger, poverty, and malnutrition when access, availability, and utilization of food increases. The team of advisors in the food safety division that I manage in the Bureau for Resilience and Food Security is ready to provide the necessary technical assistance to support. Secondly, from where I sit, momentum for increasing global food safety is again picking up with no signs of slowing. I'm encouraged by the recent launch of the World Health Organization's Global Food Safety Strategy and their Food Safety Community of Practice. I'm also paying attention to the African Union, which has prioritized food safety as part of delivering on the African Union's Year of Nutrition. This shows tremendous leadership and appetite for transformative change. Finally, collaboration across food system stakeholders is needed to address food safety issues at scale. We know this. There's a role for everyone in improving the safety of food. Scaling up food safety in low and middle income countries necessarily involves key actions on the part of the private sector, government, and donors, and others. Many food safety solutions are known and relatively cost effective. We must increase investment in commercializing research outputs where they make sense. And at the same time, we must continue to invest in research on cost effective food safety approaches to increase sustainability and potential for replication. We're so excited to hear from our guest panelists who represent the Global Food Safety Initiative, Harvey Foods, and the Feed the Future Food Safety Innovation Lab. And with that, I'll turn it over to Anne Girardi. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kelly, and thank you very much for inviting me today. I'm very happy to see so many people from all over the world. So my name is Anne Girardi, and I work at the Global Food Safety Initiative since 7 years now. For those who don't know GFSI, we are historically a benchmarking organization of food safety certification program owners. So those who are actually owning food safety standards and providing third-party audits in supply chain for the buyers. GFSI was created 22 years ago now. And on top of the benchmarking activity that we have done since 22 years, we have developed public-private partnerships. And I'm in charge of building programs, projects with regulators, public agencies, agencies like Kelly. And as Kelly has said, more than ever, collaboration is necessary between the public and the private sector. And one of my roles is trying to enhance that collaboration between the two sectors. The steering committee of GFSI is made of some of the biggest retailers and manufacturers of this world who have been the one using GFSI since the beginning, deciding that safe food is a pre-competitive issue and that they should all share the best practices on safe food all the time with their peers to avoid any more food safety crises, scandals, and recalls, because when one stakeholder is in trouble, the entire industry and the entire trust, the consumer trust, is at risk. And so that's why GFSI was mainly created.
Seems we lost Anne, so we might give her a minute and then perhaps we should continue on. Oh, yeah.
Sorry about that, guys. Can you hear me again?
There you go.
Yes, sorry about that. So as I was saying, on top of the certification program at GFSI, 10 years ago, we created the Global Markets Program, which was a program to help smaller and medium enterprise to improve their food safety management systems through the certification level, at the certification level, sorry. And we're in the middle of completely reshaping that capability building approach to make it completely new, much more inclusive, much more cost effective and accessible for less sophisticated food business operator. The GFSI steering committee with the consumer goods firm, which I work for, decided that we need to stop at GFSI only serving the top of the iceberg with the biggest suppliers of this world, but we need to serve everyone in the supply chain, from informal markets to humanitarian buyers to less sophisticated food business operators in very emerging markets to farmers in Arkansas or in France. We need to serve everyone with a new capability building framework that is inclusive, that is open to everyone who wants to access to any food business operator who needs help. And we also need to much more take into consideration in that future capability building framework the sustainable development goals that are linked to food safety. And that will be a challenge for any food business operators and for the food systems now and in the future. So we've conducted stakeholders consultations for the past 2 years to build that new framework. We will be able to release it hopefully at the beginning of next year. We are going to a final stage of strategic design and preparation of some pilots, actually. And what we want to do in that framework, as I said, is to have a platform which is focused on providing educational content on food safety from everyone who wants to share educational content. We also want to make sure that the sustainable development goals are much more taken into consideration. We did a consultation recently with our stakeholders and a webinar on June 7 for World Food Safety Day, where all our stakeholders told us, yes, we do want more of the SDGs in the future framework of GFSI. Those SDGs are the SDGs 1, 2, 3, of course, but the SDG 3 is better health, so we think it's paramount to the others. We talked also about the SDGs 17, which is about strengthening partnership. We talked about SDG 6 and 12, 6 being on water and 12 on contaminants. And what we want to do is to include some elements on those SDGs in the future capability building framework so that there are more data that we can also have on who is making safe food today and who is having issues today and who needs help in this world to make sure that we provide a safe ecosystem of service providers, donors, buyers, accessible to those food business operators, educators, trainers, so that those FBOs are fully equipped to build and strengthen all their capabilities to be equipped on producing safer food for everyone. And we think that will help diversify also supply chain as the world needs more and more food business operator with more and more supplies in food. We can see it with the invasion of Ukraine by Russia that actually we need to diversify the supply chain to make sure that it's much more inclusive and much more diversified. So that's also why we believe that future framework will help in that sense. So thank you very much for inviting me. And now I think I'm going to leave the floor to my colleague on this panel, Halimatu. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you very much, Anne, and thank you, Nika, for this invitation. Good morning, everybody. I'm very happy to be here today, and thank you for this opportunity to introduce Calvi Food, as well as the impact of the Feed the Future business drivers for food safety. Let me introduce myself. My name is Adimatu Jain. I am an engineer in statistics and I am 30 and I am in this business since I'm 25. Next slide. So Kavi Food is leading the way to contribute to food safety and food security in Africa. How? Let's introduce Kavi Food first. Next. So Kavi Food is the first beef jerky company in Senegal. Kavi Food products are presented in 30 gram format after drying and consist of 75% of protein. The product already enjoyed the consumer confidence and is approved by an FAA authorization, which is an authorization for manufacture and sale. In addition to a diversification of taste for meat and products with the introduction of dried fruit as pineapple and mango. Next. So let's talk about the business drivers for food safety support for Kavi Food. Kavi received valuable support from Feed the Future business driver for food safety. Next. It should be noted that the support of the BD4FS was before this support, Kavi Food was certainly aware of the need for action concerning food safety, but did not know where to start or the real impact of good monitoring in terms of food safety. So today, with the support of business drivers for food safety, Kavi Food was able to implement the product traceability system, benefit from technical assistance. And for the technical assistance, we can cite three steps. The first one is about the onward flow principle. No crisscrossing issues between raw material, finished product, waste, and stuff. The separation of dirty and clean area. The second technical assistance is about drafting operational procedure and implementing PRP, which is the prerequisite process. And finally, to prepare the client food safety audit, which is the third technical assistant. It does not stop there because there is also the commercial and strategic relationship with participation in the International Agriculture Show in West and Central Africa. Next. So after all this support, Kavi Food was able to pass the ocean quality control specialist assessment. And let me tell you, Auchan is the largest supermarket chain in Senegal. So it developed the proposal for a new supply contract for 2022, which led to a contract validation with the Auchan at top about above. And Kavi Food is thus more aware of food safety on business results and therefore can predict in the long run an increase in turnover of 20%. Next. Once adjustments are made to Kavi Food regarding food safety, it will be possible to export given compliance with international regulation and standards. The first point is closely linked to the expansion of production with greater control of awareness of food safety. Thus, we will note an increase in the number of partners in compliance with quality requirement and increase also the consumer confidence and therefore greater business impact. And the last point will be a greater social impact of the company in accordance with the Sustainable Development Goals. Next. With the support of business driver for food safety, the next step will consist of the construction of a new facility that will meet the international HACCP standards and the creation of a certification in local food safety standards accessible to small and medium sizes enterprises. And this last one could be an intermediate phase until the final obtaining of the HACCP certification, which is much more expensive for those small and medium businesses. Next. Let's remember that in recent years, Kavi Food has been customer database of more than 2,000, more than 7 point of sale, 11,000 followers, and the product is accessible in 6 regions in Senegal. And now we have reached more than 30,000 packages sold since its beginning. Next. Then in the 5 next years, it is planned 2,000 point of sale, more than 300 employees, direct and indirect, a presence in more than 20 countries, and 30% minimum profit with a cost of $200,000. Next. Our mission is to contribute to food security for Africans by ensuring the financial independence of farmers and ranchers. Next. And through this mission, the social impact will be in line with these 3 sustainable development goals, as no poverty, zero hunger, and decent work and economic growth. Next. So in order to help Carvey Food carry out this mission, the business driver for food safety has already started the path through support on food security. And 2 other ways to help us is to strengthen the distribution network for local products and to build on the social impact mentioned above. Fund business expansion and scale up too. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Alima too. We will now hand things over to Andrea and Abiodun.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending on where you are in the world. I'm Andrea Burstman, an Associate Professor of Nutrition at the University of Alaska Fairbanks and the PI of a project that was recently funded by the Feed the Future Food Safety Innovation Lab that focuses on the intersection of food safety and nutrition among households with young children in Nigeria. I'm delighted to be co-presenting today with Dr. Abiodun Atoloye from Utah State University. And we were tasked with sharing how building an evidence base through research can inform food safety policy and practice, using this recently funded project as an example. The World Health Organization estimates of the global burden of foodborne diseases has helped bring awareness to the link between food safety, food security, and public health. And it also brought to light just how much work remains to be done to build strong food safety systems, especially in Africa, where about a third of global foodborne illness mortality occurs. Nigeria is the most populous country in Africa and is a priority region for understanding drivers of foodborne illness and how to prevent it for a number of reasons. Published estimates on foodborne illness mortality in Nigeria range from more than 30,000 to 200,000 per year, depending on the data source. And these numbers are indicative of 2 issues. First, foodborne illness is a major public health threat, is a major public health problem. And second, the wide range in estimates is indicative of the challenges involved in monitoring foodborne illness. Since cases of foodborne illness go largely unrecognized and or underreported, these numbers are likely underestimates. The FAO estimates that 57% of Nigerians experience food insecurity, with about 21% experiencing severe food insecurity. And these statistics highlight the critical importance of understanding how to make sure that the food that is available is both safe and nutritious. Children are particularly vulnerable to foodborne illness, which can both cause and exacerbate malnutrition. Nigeria has among the highest infant mortality rates in the world, and malnutrition is thought to contribute to about half these deaths. And more than a third of children under the age of 5 are stunted. The social ecological model offers a useful framework to think about how policy, community, household, and individual level factors interact to support or hinder food safety. Although there have been a number of studies looking at consumers' food safety knowledge, attitudes, and practices, little has been done looking at the context where these attitudes are shaped and practices occur, which is to say at some of these higher levels. Although many gaps in understanding and preventing foodborne illness remain, it's likely that most contamination and risk happens in informal environments, so street-vended foods, informal markets, and preparation and consumption in households. Eat Safe recently launched its program in Nigeria that will provide much-needed information on how to improve the safety of nutritious foods in informal market settings, through formative research on vendor and consumer perceptions of food safety. Our recently funded project builds on previous and existing efforts and hopes to improve food safety and related nutrition outcomes at a household level through a contextual and community-based approach through two broad objectives. The first is taking a critical look at household vulnerability to foodborne illness, and the second is facilitating discussions between key stakeholders who play a role in multiple levels of this social ecological model, so including mothers and policymakers. One of our primary objectives is to develop a more robust understanding of the links between risky household food safety practices by collecting household surveys, the prevalence of pathogens in households, and child nutrition status. So here I will turn it over to Abiodun.
Thank you, Andrea. In addition to this qualitative data Andrea has mentioned, we are interested in obtaining qualitative data that will speak to the nuances that cut across cultural and other contextual factors, including the household environment that influence food safety behaviors among mothers. We plan to recruit 10 mothers from 5 local governments in Ibadan who will serve as citizen scientists. These women will be trained to use the Have a Voice discovery tool, a mobile application. And with this tool, they will be asked to capture photographic data about the barriers and facilitators to providing safe nutrition to their children. They will then come together with other women who are also citizen scientists like them to share their photos and discuss ways to improve food safety. We are also interested in elevating the voice of mothers in this narrative and would like them to be an active part of the solutions and advocate for a change that they would like to see. This means involving them in the stakeholders' discussion, which I will get to in one of the subsequent slides. To facilitate discussions between key stakeholders and identify solutions to improve food safety, we would like to get the perspective of the stakeholders on food safety in their community. We will recruit primary healthcare providers, community development personnel in the local government, community-based organizations, and also representatives from the state ministry, as well as people from the civil societies. These stakeholders will be interviewed to elucidate their assets and challenges around food safety regulations and foodborne illness prevention. The goal is to identify the strengths and opportunities they have to improve food safety in the community they work with, as well as their weaknesses and possible threats to their work. We believe that the dissemination of findings and engagement of stakeholders are essential to improving food safety. We will first bring combination of food safety indicators from our survey, anthropometric data, environmental sanitation enumeration, and our voice activity to develop a map of community level food illness vulnerability using spatial analysis. This will help identify priority areas for future food safety intervention programming. We will also create a story map, which is a geographical narrative of events in our study sites using quantitative data from the survey, textual and visual data from our voice activity. The purpose is for stakeholders to have information needed so that they can make strategic decisions for programs that aligns with salience issues that mothers face. We will share this map with a group of key stakeholders that would include youths from our study sites, mothers, primary health care providers, community development personnel in the local government, representatives from the state and civil society. And we will ask them to participate in a nominal group technique discussion to identify and prioritize programs and policy actions to improve household food safety. We are excited that our work will contribute to the body of evidence on food safety in Nigeria and Africa, and hope that the combination of outcomes can be used to increase awareness of food safety practices among consumers, to enhance connections between community, private and public health entities to monitor and improve food safety, and to also improve food safety at the household level. We acknowledge the other team members from different institutions in Nigeria, and we look forward to answering questions you have for us. Thank you.
Thank you to all of our excellent panelists for those presentations. We learned of the importance of public-private partnerships and capacity building, heard a great case study of what is possible when businesses adopt improved food safety practices, and emphasize the importance of research in this process. I think one of the key themes that we're seeing throughout all these presentations is the importance of collaboration. So I would like to begin our Q&A session on that note. As has been noted, if you have questions for the presenters, please utilize the Q&A box on the right-hand side of your screen, and we can answer them during the remaining time for this webinar. On that note of collaboration, I want to start with a question that Fenta entered into the chat box, which is, in Africa, where food security is still a great concern, how can we collaborate to improve not only food safety, but food security? And where is the biggest areas of opportunity for these collaborations? And I'll open that to the group of presenters.
Thank you very much for that question, Nika. So I'll be speaking from the angle of research. Yeah, I know that for actions to be made to address issues around food, whether food security or food safety, data is needed. And being able to provide information in a simple format that the stakeholders can easily understand. And that is where the approach we are using in our own research comes in. I would tie it to the mapping, and because when you have information dating or p-values or all the statistical terminologies, stakeholders might not really understand. And for actions to be made, data would be needed in a simpler format for them to understand where actions need to take place and where they need to channel their resources on. I can turn it over to any other person that would like to answer that question.
With that, we can move on to our next question from the Q&A. What are the critical challenges that local private sector companies face to establish quality distribution channels to ensure food safety? And what are some of the practical examples of how these challenges can be addressed sustainably? I'll hand this over to Anne, and then if anyone else has something to contribute, love to hear your thoughts. Over to you, Anne.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the question. So I think there are three answers to that first piece of questions on the challenges. First is infrastructure is always a challenge, the lack of good infrastructure in terms of logistics, access to water is a big issue. The second one, it's actually capacities. So how do we make sure that the food business operators are having access to capacities? And by access, I mean access to good financing channels, appropriate financing channels. I saw the question from Senegal as well on the loans, to also build more capacities in terms of having the right resources, the right staff, being able to write the right to buy the right materials, the right machines, and to establish the good processes. And those, I think, are the real challenges in those linked to food safety and establishing good quality channel. Now, the answer to those challenges is, I think, a lot linked to developing the right and the good level of food safety culture in a company. No matter where you are in the world, if you have the right food safety culture, you will be able to make your company and your operations much more resilient, whatever the risk, the external risks are, and those risks being access to financing or to infrastructure. So if you have and you're able to make sure that everyone understands from the top to the bottom, what is food safety, what is its role in terms of defending, protecting, managing risk of food safety in the organization, you have the right food safety culture in your company. If you are able to reward, maintain discipline, management of risk in your operations, you have the right food safety culture. And if you have the right traceability, the right compliance to the processes, to the regulation, and you're able to also educate and constantly make sure that you are in the improving approach of food safety, you have the right food safety culture, constantly monitoring your risk and making sure it's always a learning curve. Those are the right elements to have a food safety culture, and you will have then an organization that will be much more agile and resilient. Thank you.
Thank you, Anne. I'll move on to another question. This one is from Fenta, and they ask, is zero hunger a practical goal? And in continents like Africa, where war and illiteracy and corruption are commonly and deeply planted, is this zero hunger goal practical? And then there's a follow-up question of, if not, then what is a realistic target or approach to hunger in Africa? And I'll open this one up to the full list of panelists if someone wants to tackle this.
I can try to tackle that. That's a big question and a very good question. I would say that I won't answer the question about whether it's practical or feasible, but I do think it's appropriate and that it's important to monitor progress towards zero hunger. And I think that the fact that we may not be on track towards achieving zero hunger right now, I think that the question highlights the importance of considering other factors like literacy when developing sustainable and effective solutions. And that we need to take a holistic approach when thinking about food safety and food security. But the question about whether it's practical or feasible, that is a good question, but I do think it's an appropriate goal.
Does anyone have anything else they'd like to add to Andrea?
Yes, this is Kelly Cormier. Thank you, Andrea, for your response. I definitely want to hear from the other panelists, but I did want to underscore that this is an appropriate goal. It's an important ambition. And one of the things that I'm really encouraged by is the Global Food Safety Initiative's declaration of commitment to also contributing to addressing this really important sustainable development goal, along with some of the other sustainable development goals. And I think one of the things that I also wanted to note, that while these goals are very ambitious, we must have them. It's kind of non-negotiable. We have to work towards these goals. I'll also acknowledge that in my memory, there was a time when we would work towards high-level development goals, such as reducing poverty, such as reducing malnutrition, increasing food security, and when we didn't include this concept of food safety and addressing the risks of safe food, I think that our ambition wasn't big enough. So I really want to, I'm really excited that we're able to wrap safe food into this zero hunger ambition. Thank you.
Thank you, Kelly. If I can just say, I think those SDGs are absolutely necessary. It's the glue and the direction to which we all driving towards to. And we need to do everything we can to all drive towards that direction. And so that's why I think this is the best way for also us to have this direction at GFSI for a new capability building program. We acknowledge that food safety is everywhere because it's so important for a human being to have safe food that actually, yes, then all the SDGs are a consequence of safe food. But it's also, as you said, Kelly, it's great that it's embedded into this zero hunger goal. Thank you.
I would like to answer also about the question about the zero hunger. From my perspective, for the small companies, small and medium companies as Cave Food, a way to contribute to the zero hunger goal is to propose product with such a quality, with compliance with the food safety, make it accessible with little prices. And as they will now have the zone of free exchanges in Africa, it will be easier to make this kind of product accessible in all of the continent. So I think from my perspective that this is a way for us to contribute to the zero hunger goal. Thank you.
Thank you all for your answers to that excellent question. Alimatu, I have another question for you. We would like to hear how you heard about the Business Drivers for Food Safety project, and what was your experience working with retailers prior to addressing the certification requirements for food safety?
Yes, thank you for this question. So how I know about the project is in journal, in our newspaper. This is the way I knew about it, and I apply for this. I present the company and where I am right now. That is the way I knew it. And about the retailer, if I worked with them before I had this certification, I talked about the FRA, which is an authorization in local product here in Senegal. It is an authorization for production and sale, but it is specific to Senegal. So to answer to this question, I don't have yet the certification with compliance with international standards, but I already have this certification, this FRA, which allow me to produce and sell in Senegal. And I presided the next step with the business driver for food safety is to work on these international standards, this international certification. So this is where I am right now with the project. I think I answer to this question. Thank you.
Congratulations, Alimatu.
Thank you very much.
If you're on the GFSI pass, I guess, if Auchan is one of your customers.
Thank you for sharing those experiences, Alimatu. Our next question is open to the group, back on this theme of collaboration. Sibiodan asks, what is the best way to begin a collaboration? Food security and food safety is a large part of our innovative agriculture systems for small farm holders.
Lord Martinez.
Nika, I can take this one. And welcome others to chime in. So speaking from USAID, and I've already mentioned the Feed the Future initiative. I know there are some representatives of USAID Feed the Future partners, missions in the audience, and in the context of collaborating around development programming aligned with the Feed the Future initiative, there's a lot of opportunity. I mean, one of the things that we are advocating for is how essential it is if we have agriculture programming, we must consider where the food safety risks are, and there are tools that we can use to help identify which risks we should prioritize addressing. And a point I made earlier that I want to underscore is that if we are not addressing food safety risks within the agriculture programming that we're investing in, we have the potential the hypothesis is that we won't achieve the impacts that we're aiming for. They will not be sustainable. So I think that it becomes an imperative to think about how to address food safety risks if we're going to be developing and implementing programs that are designed to achieve food security. So from a collaboration front, I think that requires bringing in those food safety experts, those local stakeholders, and there are so many throughout the food systems. And again, it depends on where the risks are, which risks we choose to prioritize, and then identifying which local stakeholders need to be consulted. And then from there, the collaboration ensues. So I think there's just a lot of opportunity, and there are already a lot of wonderful examples. Certainly, we can reach back to USAID for additional examples, and we can do a better job of sharing those where they're happening. Thank you.
Thank you, Kelly. And I'd like to hear your thoughts as well on what is the best way to start these collaborations.
Oh, that's a great point. I think, it is essential to have access to the right knowledge. And I think some of the collaborations are the way to share the critical level of information. And that's where collaboration is necessary. I think what USAID is doing in terms of providing research, scientific research to get to know us where the risks are and where can we make the world better is actually a great example of collaboration. Trust, transparency first, being extremely transparent with your stakeholders, saying this is my issue, or what is your issue, how can I help you is the key in asking the basic questions for the collaboration as well, and doing things together. I have a colleague from FAO who actually is also always asking what are the similarities where we can work together, and that's before knowing what do we have in common and where we can do something together, we need to know each other. So, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, so I have a response to that as well. So I know that one way to connect is to reach out to people. I know this issues need different sector coming on board to address issues, people from the food production, researchers, and based on my experience as a researcher, I understand the partnership between even community members, maybe in the agriculture, the Zoha, in the food sector, food producer or food processor, reaching out to like researchers to find how they can benefit each other. So exploring opportunity, there are opportunities out there that can be explored. Similarly, researchers are also looking for people to work with, to partner with in their research. So just reaching out to as many entities whose interest aligns with yours is one way to establish partnership. Thank you.
Thank you all for those answers. I'd next like to combine two well-liked questions from Casa and Alette. The global challenges of both climate change and the conflict in Ukraine and Russia needs collaborative approaches along the entire value chain. What are some key strategies that actors in food security need to start using now to be proactive? I'd love to hear all of your thoughts, but I'll hand things over to Anne first to get us started.
Thank you very much. So one of the first, I think key is the world will need more food and from more diversified sources, all right? So whatever we do to empower, grow small food business operators all over the world to make sure they know how to produce safe food, nutritious food, will be key. So I think this is the first objective in whatever we do to make sure that food security in the future is tackled. And with the global context, it's even more relevant. So making sure that we have more and more food business operators that are created, and the one that exists can be actually nurtured in a way that they can grow to their full potential, which is not the case today, is key. I think also the second point for me from a GFSI standpoint is what I kind of unfortunately discovered when I arrived at GFSI, and I am an economist, so I was extremely shocked, and that's also why I'm driving that change at GFSI in building a new capability building framework. The GFSI certification is for products that are being exported. So products that are being produced in Africa or in Latin America or in Southeast Asia, they require a level of safe food that is great. And those safe food are going for exports to the international markets. And for the domestic markets, well, they're using the GFSI Global Markets Program, which has smaller requirements. And I refuse, as GFSI, the GFSI tools to be used to make a two-speed system. It will continue to have a two-speed system, where actually safer food goes for exports and for domestics, well, we are less regarding. So I think everyone deserves safe food, and we all need to take our part, and especially GFSI and the GFSI members, to build a system, a capability building program that helps everyone to have the highest level of safe food. And climate change, I believe climate change and the risk on food security and food safety, it's just like food fought 15 years ago. You need to have an understanding of the context, the environment you're in. And you need to understand your risk. And in the future, I think we'll have, just like we have food fraud mitigation plan, we'll have climate risk assessment plan and mitigation plan for any food business operators. And that's why I believe, I hope we'll be able to develop a system where we can know with the food business operator or they develop those plans, those climate risk assessment plan in the future, so that they can understand the risk on their operations and their environment in the future in the capability building framework that we are building. Thank you.
Thank you, Anne. Kelly, I'd like to hear your thoughts too on proactive strategies to climate and conflict, and perhaps you can mention the importance of food loss and waste in these strategies as well.
Yeah, thanks, Nika. And since this, I might as well also note that this this webinar is part of USAID's month-long celebration of World Food Safety Day, and they're on AgriLinks. We've also featured a blog that does link climate change to food safety. And as you noted, so anyway, I encourage everybody to take a look at that. And as you noted, Nika, one of the things that that we've spent some time conceptually linking is how food loss and waste is integrally linked to food safety, but also to climate change strategy goals. So maybe I'll just leave my comment there. There we have explored this question in that blog, and I encourage everybody to take a look. And I know we're almost at time, so Nika, I'm gonna pass it back to you. Thanks.
Thank you, Kelly. Let's have one more question to wrap up. Another one from the chat. Food safety is a huge problem in many underdeveloped countries. Food adulteration is widespread, partly because of the low level of knowledge of producers and traders, and weak capacity of regulators, and corruption also adds to the problem. What can we do to help ameliorate the issue of food adulteration in particular? Does anyone want to take this one? Anne, do you want to get us started?
Yes, sorry. So I think, again, food safety culture is critical. And following the international regulatory framework, the international regulation and national regulation is key. Making sure also it's something we didn't talk about today, but developing the lab infrastructure in countries is critical. And when I was talking about infrastructure before, I think that's key as well. So developing, investing in lab, independent lab infrastructure is key. Food safety culture discipline is absolutely critical. Investing in logistics, in the supply chain, in the cold chain is critical as well. So that's one. And to finish also, I would add also that's right, coming to the previous question, that food waste and trying to eliminate food waste will be key in the future on food security as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Anne. And thank you all so much for your excellent questions and participating in this discussion. And thank you again to Kelly and our excellent panelists, Anne, Alimatu, Andrea, and Abiodun for this really great conversation. Food safety to improve food security. That it concludes our webinar. We are at time, so thank you all so much for joining today and engaging in this important conversation.
Thank you.